This is a HeadGum Podcast.
The beloved Halloween Spooktacular returns to talk about... Hellraiser 3, Hell on Earth. Oh, fuck me. I'm Andrew Jupin.
Steven Sadak.
Chris Cabinbite.
Eric Siska.
That's, if there was ever a call for an Eric Sisko bite.
I don't want to be a Cenobite.
And we hate movies.
We all go a little mad sometimes.
You know, it's Halloween. I guess everyone's entitled to one good scare, huh?
Sometimes. That is better.
Time to keep your appointment with the Wicker Man.
They're coming to get you, Barbara.
You sick fucks, you've seen one too many movies.
Nah, Sid, don't you blame the movies. Movies don't create psychos. Movies make psychos more creative.
What's the fucking
motion in the bag? What an excellent day for an exorcism.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to the program. Thank you for tuning in, as always. This is it, gang. The 2018 Spooktacular is now on.
I just want for one time, like, there's going to be a big shot movie producer who listens to this show, and he's like, you know that one guy, that Chris Cabinobite was the best one. I want to give him $1 million check. And he lists the whole thing. Well, I can't find this Chris Cabinobite. I guess I'll burn this $1 million check.
sir.
No, but that's it's a joke name.
I would purposely always pronounce that Cabinobite, though. How cool does that sound? We are talking about Hellraiser 3, Hell on Earth from 1992, directed by Anthony Hickcox. I love names like that because it just sounds like hiccup.
Yeah, a little bit. Oh,
just worry. To bully this guy's name a little bit up top.
Someone will tweet us and say it's pronounced Hickcox.
I do think you get an extra point if you're a horror director with an X in your name.
Yes, that's pretty boss. It is pretty boss, man.
And what X is in horror? What does that signify? Is that like a cross or something?
Danger.
Like the mystery. Like the poison bottles.
Much like the poison bottles.
They have the X gene, much like the X-Men.
Oh, nice.
And also the fine line between horror and pornography.
Oh, that's right. Yes. Oh, that's the finest of lines. If you can find it. So I will say up top, I'm not, and I think I've made this abundantly clear on the air over the years, I'm not what you'd call a quote-unquote fan of this franchise. I don't like these movies.
Well, that's because it sucks.
Yeah. But I understand where people will say, like, oh, even the first one, what, I mean, I don't like the whole, I don't like watching people get flayed, man.
Yeah, I'm kind of there. Mm. I actually think the first one's totally fine and almost even like a good movie.
Uh-huh. Mm.
It's just kind of not for me. Like it's totally. Yeah. I think it's good. Actually,
it's okay to like a fucking franchise.
I'll go on the record. The first one's good. The rest are not.
Yeah, the first one's got the best like narrative. It feels more like a real horror movie.
Yeah, like a movie.
It is like a movie.
Like Steve, I'll be honest. Okay, The Nun are great, and the rest are. Garbage.
Oh, you liked The Nun?
The Nun.
You saw The Nun, bro?
No, not The Nun.
N-O-N-E. I see what Chris Cabin was going with.
The absence of these movies.
I thought he was talking about newly terrifyingly released film, The Nun.
There's a Netflix knockoff Nun, I think. Or maybe it's on Amazon. It's one of those like...
It's an asylum piece.
Yeah, it's like you can't copyright a religious outfit. Gotcha.
And it's just straight up
called
The Nun?
It's a scary nun, or it's like, yeah, something like that.
You fucking scumbags.
Yeah. So, you know, I got a question about this franchise.
Sure.
I don't think it makes much sense. Uh-huh. Because it's like, okay, Lucifer Falls, right? We got that. Boom.
Check.
Okay. Yeah, there you go.
We got a timeline
so
going.
We're staying way back there.
Well,
okay.
I mean, where's the foundation of hell?
Sure. Prologue.
If we're starting there, I'm going to run out of whiteboard over here.
Yeah, okay. Established year zero, or is it one? I don't know. Whatever Christ died. Wait, no. He's not related to this.
No, he's not.
He's like
not
a cousin. Kissing cousin to Lucifer. Okay. So Lucifer Falls.
Yes.
Sure.
Where do they get all these fucking like chains and puzzle boxes already? Like, no, wouldn't it be like ropes?
Well, as we're
like
told,
the early days, like in that era, would a Cenobite show up and like shoot ropes at you?
Are you just forgetting Hell's industrial period?
I mean,
over the years they have built
up. What I mean,
all it takes is one crooked blacksmith to get damned, and now we're making chains.
I know, but this is like this is like Industrial Revolution stuff.
I gotta say, if you jump one sequel ahead, I think whatever the one is where it's like multiple time periods,
that is the next one.
Bloodline, I believe. In that one, you are shown the construction of like the original puzzle box or whatever.
Okay,
and it's this motherfucker just carving shit out of wood, and it's kind of funny because like it's this dude like. Blood, sweat, and tears, like crafting this puzzle box
this
or whatever.
This was an evil tree I cut down.
And it's awesome because, like, his wife comes in and he's like, it's done. And she's like, oh, that's it. And this dude is so insulted. It's fucking hilarious. But it was originally made out of wood.
Oh, that's crazy. So now did someone...
Like George Washington's teeth.
Yeah, I mean, like back then.
George Washington had Hellraiser puzzle boxes for teeth.
Oh, dude, the Cenobites got Martha. Don't worry about it.
Back in that era, like a Cenobite would just like suffocate you with hay or something.
Yeah.
Suffocated with hay.
Benedict
oh, God.
Arnold was definitely a Cenobite. And then they were just like, oh, yeah, no. No. We're not going to tell everyone about the Cenobites. This is a war. It's a tense situation. Cenobites are just traitors. They're just traitors.
Benedict, could you take your leather outfit off and put on this? Okay. You put it on over it. That's fine. No, that's fine too. Yeah. Either, whatever.
He's got like a tri-corner hat, like melded into his skull.
Yeah. All we've got is paper and cloth here, buddy. I don't know what you're looking for.
So, I mean, I don't know if you've seen a Hellraiser movie or not. Paul Reiser in Hellraiser.
Oh, what am I going to do? Look at all this. We got people coming over for dinner. I got the Pinhead over here. Oh, my God. James, help me out here.
I have such terrible pleasures to show you.
Me and this adorable dog are going to open up this puzzle box.
And here's hell is mad about you.
Here was a true fright the other day. My wife and I happened to unfortunately be walking through Times Square. You know who we saw?
Who's that?
Cousin Paulie.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I was like, what's this fucker doing walking 42nd
Street? Oh, no, you mean Cousin Ira.
Oh, Ira.
Yeah.
I called him Cousin Paulie that day, too.
Oh, did you yell it out?
No, I was like, Chelsea, look, Cousin Paulie. And she was like, who?
Yeah.
Yeah, Cousin Ira. Gosh. I fucking saw Cousin Ira.
So the guy's like, what?
Isn't it Cousin Ira's girlfriend who's in this?
No.
Cousin Ira's girlfriend.
JD, the girl, Joey, the girl that Joey takes in.
Oh, no. Terry? Yeah, no, that's actually...
She was on it. She was on
She
Mad
might have been
about
on Mad
you.
About You. She was on everything. She's in PCU, I believe, for a little bit.
Oh, is that right? Oh, wow, much more accomplished than I thought. You see these people sometimes that come through these Hellraiser movies. It's like...
this picks up sort of after the last movie wherein the Pinhead is sort of destroyed because the Ashley Lawrence, that lady, shows him his humanity and he's like, thank you for releasing me. And then he dies.
Yeah.
Blah, 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 bunch of stuff happens. And now we open up and it's a whole new game for the Hellraiser franchise.
And
we're leaving that whole family alone.
Right. But this is where it's like, you got to stop making these movies because this is a thing. I believe it's firmly right from here, even though... The next one is like all about the mythology and whatnot. Sure. But this is like, we had a script that's just a thing about something. And then it's like, we'll just jam some Hellraiser shit in it.
That's not this. That's the later of the...
But doesn't this feel like this, though? Like, I know the later most definitely. But this one's just like, it's a scuzzy club owner that's got this like BDSM club / five-star restaurant.
That we'll get there.
I don't know.
Question mark.
It just feels like two movies are constantly fighting each other.
Well, I'll say it does feel like an early script of Dark City. Because this,
you're right.
When it starts, like desolate, nothing, blackness, and then JD, this sadomasochistic fucking club owner, JP, okay, Morgan, no, okay,
close, and, Monroe,
and he goes to this art gallery in the middle of fucking nowhere, Brooklyn.
It's like a wind chime store mostly. It's mostly wind chimes.
We sell mostly wind chimes, but also haunted artifacts.
And it's amazing because it's got this hobo working there who is obviously a haunted hobo. The first two movies...
Haunted hobo? I'd watch that movie.
It's true because later on, someone's like walking a dog outside. And they're like, what do you mean that art gallery? It burned down 20 years ago.
That must have been a haunted hobo who gave you that necklace.
Never buy art from a hobo. Good life lesson. Mm.
And no, never buy art because it's like, wow, it's this pillar and you could clearly see Pinhead's head sticking out of it and the box there.
It's right there.
And the guy's like, wow, this is going to be cool. How much do you want for it? And he's like, how much are you willing to sell it? How much are you willing to part for it? And I'm like, yeah, no, I'm cool. Thanks yeah. so much.
Yep. No, because that's a hobo response. That guy's, you could be like, I would like to buy this sculpture for a can of beans.
Actually, it needs to be a bit more than a Werther's candy. I need something here.
Oh, no, not with the Werther's again, dude. How about three hots and a cot?
You can get that by just throwing a brick through a window and
getting arrested.
Yes,
yeah.
Yes,
oh,
yes.
Absolutely.
But you know, again, we actually should support the homeless in this country,
sure.
and give them a place to sleep and some food, and we should actually keep them away from Hellraiser artifacts.
That's exactly. True. That's the thing, is if we keep them off the streets, they don't become haunted hobos.
Exactly.
If you have no hobos at all, zero chance of a haunted hobo.
I don't know. I think this hobo gets out of there like scot free. He gets like what, $10 from this fucking asshole, and then he takes
he vanishes basically.
Yeah,
right?
He certainly goes never away seen again. Yeah.
You never know if he was like, you know, really there.
Does he go down to hell? Does he have like a little staircase behind a couch where he's doing that little thing?
Let me go check in the basement. So this scumbag buys this sculpture that's clearly haunted.
And I mean, how does he transport? This must be a days long event.
Yeah, no, yeah. Thanks to the magic of editing, the movie doesn't have to worry about any of that.
First of all, you have to move all of the wind chimes out of the front of the store. Correct. Out of there, because you're going to be moving, you got to get a whole moving crew out there.
And nothing breaks more easily than wind chimes, oh, dude, God. So you got to get those right out of the way. This is the pyramid gallery, by the way.
Try and untangle a wind chime? Fucking forget it. That's a Hellraiser. That's a lament configuration.
Oh, the lament puzzle configuration.
I have such frustrating day chores to show you. Oh, looks like your Apple iPhone headphones are wrapped in your pocket. Good luck unsolving that riddle. Look at all these coins and crumbs at the bottom of your backpack. Oh, how about this? Your zipper on your hoodie went over the fabric. Oh, what a distasteful challenge that awaits you.
Or this happened to me this weekend.
Ooh, you're changing an overhead fluorescent light bulb in your house, but you accidentally drop it, and you have to keep two cats away from it.
Oh dude, wow, that is a hell spawn challenge.
Dude, it was fucking all fucking Saturday.
That's insane.
Yeah.
Just shattered. Just
shattered, like a little, like, and all everywhere. Those little, you know, a fluorescent light bulb. It's, yeah. Like, turns into
it's
powder.
It's like dust. You can breathe that in, and it'll just rip apart you like a Cenobite.
Like not unlike a Cenobite. Oh man, a fucking fluorescent Cenobite.
Oh yep,
that's I'm into yep. it.
Ooh yeah, he's just like chewing glass. Hey, so Doug Bradley plays Pinhead. He played Pinhead for most of the movies. He doesn't anymore. As of 2018, we are still putting out Hellraiser movies, by the way.
Insane.
It's craziness. But let me ask you guys this about Doug Bradley. Mm. How? Uh-huh. On a scale of like 1 to Tim Burton, how creepy is this guy's house? You think he's into it, or is he like, just a role?
I think he's got a poster somewhere, for sure. That, yeah. I think, is definitely happening.
I think you're right, in his study. And then other than that, I think he stays clear of it.
Yeah, yeah.
I was like, Clive with the leather again.
Right, because you know Clive Barker's the weirdo here, right? Yes. He's got a real fucking Prince of Darkness mansion.
The problem with being Pinhead, professionally being Pinhead, is every
birth... Not amateurishly being Pinhead, but not a Halloween costume.
Every Christmas and birthday, you're getting Pinhead gifts. You're getting like, oh, yeah. Look, you're into dark shit. Well, actually, I just like, oh, okay, cool.
Well, I just played King Lear, but fine. I'll take your fucking bondage costume.
Another double-sided spiky dildo. Thank you so much. I'll put it with the rest.
Oh, the good thing about these joke gifts is that they never stop being funny.
That's not half as bad as he probably gets fucking talked down to by Kane Hodder and Robert Englund. Dude, at yeah. all these goddamn...
Give it a wedgies at the conventions.
Oh, Mr. Pinhead, can't even get your name in the title there, huh?
I like it. I think he's right. I think
point.
We're onto something here. But fucking Kane Hodder. Oh wow, Kane Hodder. You know, excellent acting there, Kane.
At least I had a line.
Oh, I love the idea of all these like horror guys just fucking sniping at each other.
Yo, get Warlock in here. Doug Bradley's in.
Oh, fuck. Here comes Englund. Everybody just pretend you don't see him.
Oh, Robert, hi. I read about the Goldbergs. Super exciting. I'm definitely going to tune in.
Jesus Christ. I saw an ad for that on Twitter, and I couldn't scroll away faster. He's talking about how, like, he can't like play the character anymore. He's like, I can't whip my neck around fast. And I'm like, yeah, because you're an old man, dude. It's fine. And really, the Goldbergs, it's, Jesus.
Also, the Freddy Krueger is not so much about the neck whipping. Like, congratulations.
Yeah, totally.
It's the makeup.
Also, is it like his nightmare now? Because suddenly we're still in the 80s and he's like 80 years old.
Totally stuck in the 80s forever, dude. Like, all of these characters should have been. I gotta say, this was a weird thing. This franchise, as much as I ignored it for most of my life, I think was like up front a lot. Like a lot of the Hellraiser posters, I feel, were featured in a lot of the indie video stores around.
Sure. Yeah,
like they were really plugging the shit out of something I just did not have people, any interest in watching.
People were renting it. People wanted to see that kind of stuff back then. There, you know, there was that whole like Gen X yuppie shit, which is when, you know, J.P. Monroe's business, that's what that is.
Yes, right. Yeah, yeah.
These are the people that popularized Hellraiser and cyberpunk and all the God. Other weird niches and you know, like coffee and, yes. You know, all the other things they liked.
Speaking of 80 years old, man. coffee!
Because that's what, the restaurant and the nightclub, the restaurant's much more, I guess, the yuppie thing, but they're still hip. They're still with it.
Yeah. Well, that's why J.P. Monroe, man, he's a genius. He's getting scum on both sides.
Well, he's got a restaurant and a crazy fucking grunge gutter nightclub.
Right.
And then he's got an apartment as well, all in one big complex. Well,
okay. I can't believe he's living in that apartment, man. The noise alone.
He's got great soundproofing. Excellent soundproofing.
But is it a club, a venue, a restaurant, and then an apartment?
Yeah, I think it's all of it.
That is fucking nuts.
And it's like the Four Seasons. Like, it's like really, like really, really fancy, like upscale restaurant. Oh, welcome to the Boiler Room. Are you here for the Anthrax concert or the or the Filet Mignon?
You know what it reminded me of? I was thinking about this. It was like how Cheers was like the scuzzy bar, and then you went upstairs to Melville's and you needed to put a jacket on. Mm-hmm. That's what I think this situation is. Like, you can get to the restaurant if you're inside the Boiler Room and vice versa. But like when you go into the restaurant, you got to put a jacket on. And it can't be a leather daddy jacket.
A straight jacket is what you should put on if you're going to this place.
Steve, be serious. Anthrax would never do this. This is Armored Saint. The fucking bottom of the barrel.
Another thing that always kept me away from the Hellraiser movies was I always kind of felt like I listened to the wrong music to watch those movies.
Yeah, you weren't listening to Armored Saint, apparently. Is that a
Tin Machine who appears on this, even though I love Bowie?
Yeah.
There's a Tin Machine tune on here.
Really? I didn't know that. So Tin Machine and Armored Saint, are those Cenobites?
Yes, they probably are.
Yeah, aka Cenobite names, dude.
And Wizard of Oz had a Cenobite in it.
Absolutely.
Oh, yeah, the Tin Man, right?
Absolutely.
I think that's what Pinhead, that's where he came from. Man.
Really? Yeah.
That guy showed some people some fucking delicious sights. Don't worry.
The Wizard? The Wiz?
No, the Tin Man.
Oh, yeah.
I just ate a munchkin. I'm sorry. I just flayed a delicious tiny munchkin.
I finally got the heart I wanted. No, it's not my own. It's someone else's because I'm a Cenobite. I'm the Tin Man.
I'm the Heart Ripper Cenobite.
He wanted a heart, right?
He did, yes.
He did, yes. Yeah.
And what did the lion want?
He wanted courage.
Oh. And the straw man wanted a brain.
Civilization, just like you.
Well, I mean, like, yeah, I mean, that's going, like, when Wizard of Oz, I mean, like, it's you know, most of them want biological things. It's like, courage, I don't know, dude.
Yeah.
Just, you know, gut up, man. Come on. Fuck you, lion.
Do you mean testicles? Is that what you're trying to get at here, lion? Is that you want a pair of testicles?
He just hands him a pair of testicles. What am I supposed to do with these?
Well, now I don't have to even go on the journey. I got my balls in my hand.
Rocky Mountain oysters.
That's
right.
Fry them up. Do a little hot sauce. Don't even worry about it.
Fried balls.
I'm packing a 4-pack here.
Chris, by the way, the straw man?
Yeah, whatever.
Scarecrow, motherfucker.
Not a straw man.
Straw man. You're the straw man.
Okay.
So we cut to a hospital. Where we meet Joey, who's played by Jedziah Dax.
Jedziah
Dax, for crying out loud.
Is that the actress's name?
No, Terry Farrell is the actress. She was on Star Trek Deep Space Nine. Ooh,
it's J-A-D-Z-I-A, I believe. Jedziah,
yes.
Just call her Dax. What's wrong with you?
She's Dax. But in this movie, she's playing Joey, a down-on-her-luck news anchor or a segment producer or whatever the hell
like
she is.
Like a field reporter. And it's a weird, like, she's just assigned to go stand in this emergency room and wait for something to happen.
It's
and
the,
listen, even
weirdest
if,
field I ever saw.
It is, because it's also like, I mean, I don't know if someone was just like, so here I am at St. Vincent's emergency room. I'm like, I don't care. Is the fucking, is someone of note there? Otherwise, it's an emergency room. I know things are happening.
Peyton Cinemax II. I run the TV in New York City. And I say blood and guts on the television at all times.
It's just such a stupid.
I think he's still running things. You ever watch the like the W Picks News at 10? Yo, my God, amateur hour, too fucked, dude. They're just saying shit wrong. There's shit. Everything's wrong on the fucking scroll. It's embarrassing.
It's crazy. But, they'll be like, look, someone got hit by a bus, and you're like, the story's about a plane crash.
Yeah, but they always focus on the gruesome stuff going on.
Oh yeah, man.
Pat Kearney, get down to Mount Sinai now.
Oh come on, dude. Kiernan doesn't get up from behind the desk.
He's a Canadian Cenobite. So all that means is they put a blazer on him.
I can be kind to you. Is that count? Such, I know he throws CDs. I can just be kind.
Delights.
I've got such wonderful news to read you here today in the newspaper. And she's, it's this weird story where she's like, yes, in the 15th day in a row, no one has died in New York City.
Yeah, okay.
It's the longest running streak. And that's it. And then she's like, wow, what a stupid like news segment this is going to be. Like, I want, you know, it's your
also
standard.
Also totally fake, too.
Totally. She's like, what I want is, you know.
The big stories.
She wants the big stories, et cetera, et cetera.
I thought she was on the air for this part. And yeah, so when she goes off script and is like in these stupid fucking segment producers, and I was like, whoa, she's going to get fired. But it's just like this dude, Doc, the cameraman, who, this is so embarrassing. He gets a phone call and it's like, Doc, there's a big story breaking. We need you down wherever. And he's like, oh, cool. By the way, I have Joey with me. What's that? Oh, you don't want her? Well, this is awkward.
I'm pretty sure Doc is pretty terribly dubbed in this movie. Anybody else get that from old Doc?
Oh, really?
Yeah. It's like watching. Oh. And he's just got this like Neo Tokyo voice where it's like, yes, I know. I'll be there in 2 minutes.
I did not get that from Doc at all.
I got a few bad dubs here.
Yeah, a lot of bad dubs.
I thought JP quite a few.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow. I didn't.
ADR.
I don't look at people's mouths when they talk. It's a thing about me.
Gets you too aroused.
Yes, exactly.
So this dude pieces out to go on this other assignment, and he's like, sorry, Joey, I tried. Which he does make a legitimate effort to help this woman.
Poor Doc, man. He's a nice guy.
I know. The great sights that behold him later in this movie, though. Oof.
Jesus.
So she's just sitting there like, my life is terrible, when in comes some dude with the famous chains hanging from his flesh. Brother, we got ourselves a Hellraiser.
And I was like, oh, cool, we're starting early with the Hellraising, which I appreciated.
Sure.
But then the Hellraising takes a long break after this. It's like one good Hellraising and we're done.
And who is this guy?
It's just some random fucking nobody. But I'll say this about this scene. Mm. Any movie, head explosion within first 15 minutes, I'm sending you on your way. You did very well.
I was pretty impressed by this. This dude gets lit up mightily. It's pretty awesome.
Yeah, basically, he comes in. He's got chains all over his face. And like Joey's like, wow, what's going on in there? And the chains start to get electrified or something. Mm-hmm. And then he just...
Because the electric gremlin from hell jumps into them.
Well, he sort of looks like fucking Jacob Marley with this shit. The fucking chains all over the place.
Oh, my
man.
God. Ebenezer Scrooge was visited by Cenobites.
Please, dear Cenobite, show me no more. Dear Cenobite, please tell me, what becomes of old Tiny Tim Cenobite?
Oh, well, it's a leather outfit with no nipples. It's real weird, man. You don't want to go down there, dude.
Yeah, let's just say this is your tombstone and move on. Yeah, you don't want to see that, Scrooge.
Pinhead is just like singing in the middle of town with a bunch of Muppets trying to get Michael Caine.
It's only one more day till Christmas.
Fuck, I didn't think there was a way to make Muppet Christmas Carol a better movie, but that just did it.
All right, so who would Pinhead draft in the Muppet class? You would definitely go for Sweetums first.
Yes,
you want a bruiser. Right.
Easy
sure.
recruit. Mm-hmm. Easy recruit in Sweetums.
He's halfway there anyway.
You got to get most of Dr. Teeth in the band, right. Man, because all those fucking animals, animal himself included in that.
Oh, man, give Dr. Teeth his fucking leather thing and shoot teeth at you.
Oh, my God. Shit, yeah, dude. And then from there, you know, I think Fozzie would easily cave to the dark side.
Oh, yeah.
You know,
also Waka Waka. Fozzie's also like a character you love, and he's like it's a cutesy guy. You're like, oh, no, what happened to Fozzie?
Yeah, what happened to Fozzie's nipples, dude? Look at that.
Kermit's been taking your place for far too long, Fozzie.
Well, that's the thing, is the nipples are always the first to go, it seems. And no matter what kind of Cenobite you wind up being, your nipples are trashed.
Is that like some
man? Look at those trashy nipples.
I don't know what the fascination is with cutting off the nips, man.
I guess it's like a pleasurable experience for some people.
The idea of the pleasure pain paradigm there that Pinhead is very into.
Well, listen, but if you're pulling your nipples off, how are you going to keep pinching them?
Well, that's the thing. It's one great ride, is what it is.
By the way, like this whole franchise is all just like, oh, and then we'll rip your skin off, and then we'll like start, you know, like killing you, and it's just like, okay, like sure, you know, you give me a violent enough death, whatever, but like that's it, right? Like,
yeah.
You know, like if you take me to hell and you start torturing me, what, maybe like 4 days, and then I'm immune to it, you know? Like I'm not gonna care after a point. I'm never going to exist again. I'm just, I just feel like. You do something long enough, you don't care about it anymore.
That's right. You
do
would
they
just
change
be
it up?
Regular old nipless Siska.
Yeah.
What I don't understand about Pinhead is he's doing plenty of damage without opening this fucking box to let all other fucking things come out. Yeah. Why not toss it in the fucking ocean and then kill everybody? Like, you could do that pretty easily, I think.
Not a bad plan, Chris Cabin. Your nipples shall be spared.
Oh, man, the end shot of, like, the puzzle box on, like, a Greenpeace ship.
Yeah. There you go.
That's a movie I want.
Like an ocean troller, like, gets it in a net or something.
Yeah.
You thought I was sunk.
Right before Bruce Willis fucking chips a ball at your head.
And then Pinhead's, like, shooting a chain at you. It turns out to be an anchor.
Oh, shit, just, yeah.
Yeah, it's a heavy
anchors away.
Hellraiser 5, Anchors Away.
Oh, absolutely, dude. It's a musical on the high seas.
Just that this is what all I need is. Hellraiser set X. This is Hellraiser set in New York. That's great.
Sort
Hellraiser
of.
Set in a boat. I'm into it.
It's just do the Die Hard formula.
Mm-hmm.
Die Hard on a boat, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, that's true.
Bloodline is kind of Hellraiser Tree of Life.
Okay.
It's going through the history.
You're totally right.
Is there a Cenobite dinosaur that steps on another one's head?
Or? No, but we
Father,
go to, we
you
go to space.
Constantly wrestle inside me.
We go into space, at least, in that movie. That's fun. Somehow the puzzle box gets into space, much like Jason.
So
somehow.
We meet the other girl in this movie. Is Terry? Is there character?
Terry, correct.
Is the character's name, which is confusing because the actual Terry Farrell is the other actress.
Yes.
Quite confusing. But Terry is this, she's like this, she's a frequenter of the boiler room.
She's the lady friend of the guy who gets fucked up at the beginning of the movie.
Yes. You know, she meets her here and she's like, where are you going? Oh, the boiler room. So she goes to the boiler room, and this is when we see the whole thing where it's a gutter club, and like there's cool like S&M dolls and stuff and what have you.
There's a lot of like mixed themes though,
yes,
because like for part of the bar, yeah, it's like a bondage-y situation, but then it's like a go-go club. But then also part of it, I was like, was that a vampire?
Yeah, there are bars that you can. You can get blown at, and then there's also bars that play live music. And I feel like never the twain should meet.
Sometimes you get blown at the bar, but sometimes the bar blows you.
Yeah. I mean, not just blown, but...
Yeah.
All sorts of things.
Sex happens.
Sex happens.
A sex club, what am I calling
it? Oh, really?
Yes.
Okay, and what's the address of this?
But that's the thing. If you're going to have a sex club, have a sex club.
Exactly.
Don't just have it be like a scuzzy place where fucking dicks are out. You know what I mean?
I need a couple different names. The boiler room is your sex club.
Sure.
This venue needs its own, like JP's or
Oh, that's a good move. Like three different things right next to each other. You got the sex club here. It's called the boiler room. This one's called like the steam pot or something.
Yeah,
or the
like
steam
JP pot. JP's Steakhouse.
Yeah, exactly. That just JP's Steakhouse. Because that is a nice-ass looking restaurant.
Yeah.
I've got such wonderful specials to tell you about.
It looks
wait, I didn't bring the card. Hold on, let me tell you. Oh, wait, no, it's a veal piccata. Very, very, yes.
It looks like when like they hang out with the hip people in American Psycho.
Yes.
Yes, definitely.
Yeah. Actually, the dandelion greens are braised with the pot roast. May I ask you this, the most important of questions?
Is there room for dessert? Any dietary restrictions at the table? Oh, a vegetarian. How quaint.
But yeah, so she's kind of asking around. She meets JP at this point. JP has got like all these ladies on him. He's got like all these roses he's giving out, like the bachelor kind of a
Dude,
thing.
This is fucking stupid, man. He just like, and he's got a bartender on staff who can be like, hey, Blinky, rose me.
Yeah.
And this dude like knows what's up and he like just points to like some babe.
Yeah.
And this scumbag just goes over and like gives her this rose so that like she knows JP has selected her for the evening's entertainment.
Yeah.
Yeah, it is disturbing.
It like, is this weird.
I'm already disturbed enough. Mm-hmm. Well, I don't need to see a pinhead.
I've been waiting for this guy to die since he was in the fucking art gallery. Like, yeah, I'm just.
It takes a while. Yep. It takes a very long time.
He kind of reminded me of a scummy Bobby from Twin Peaks.
Oh yeah,
yeah.
Dana, before he got his shit together and became a cop.
Before he cleaned it up. Yes. Mm-hmm. Before he cleaned up his life. Yeah. No. Shitty Bobby.
Shitty.
Season 1 and 2. Shitty Bobby.
Well, this guy's buff Bobby.
Oh, buff Bobby, look out, dude.
I guess at some point, Terry and Joey kind of get together at her apartment. Oh, Joey has a nightmare. She has these Vietnam flashbacks.
This is Terry.
Joey.
Oh, who's,
Joey's the,
damn it. Yes. Who's the actress's name is Terry. God damn it.
It's very yes. Joey, the anchor woman, the reporter, is having a nightmare where she goes to Vietnam dressed as like Alice in Wonderland, kind of. It's a bizarre outfit with a large bow in the back. It's not very practical for Vietnam.
Speaking of Tree of Life, yeah, she looks like Jessica Chastain in that movie.
And you know, she's like, she watches her dad get killed, and she's like screaming for her dad. And then she gets a phone call, and it's like this woman's like, "Hey, I thought you were looking for me." She's like, "Okay, come meet at my apartment." No. Let's meet at a coffee house.
Yeah.
Let's go meet at a bar. Yep. I'll buy you a drink. You know what I mean?
Yeah, no, I do not need this person to know where I live.
Oh, yeah, you got a pull-out couch in there?
Yes.
You got hot water?
Because this woman is, she's homeless, and right. She's looking for a hot and a cot, my friend.
And I love that expression. And so here's my biggest problem with this movie. I'll accept puzzle boxes. Sure. I'll accept demonic presences.
For Christmas?
Of all kinds. For all gifts and sure. All occasions.
Okay. I know
absolutely.
What to get you now.
But
you go to the Doug Bradley special.
Oh, my garage sale is so exquisite.
Literally get this shit out of my house. It's all waxy and smells
that
terrible.
One is a nipple ring. That one is a nipple ring. That one is a nipple ring.
No. The nipple is plastic. It is not real. I did not collect actual flesh.
This is a razor glove that somebody bought because they thought I was Freddy Krueger. I didn't have the courage to correct them.
This, the most offensive of gifts.
But no, what I find most unbelievable is the apartment that this fucking beat reporter
shit.
Has. Are you kidding me?
Well, because she's a struggling reporter, yeah. Right?
Like this
she's
is
a,
like she, April O'Neil's apartment. It's the same unbelievable shit.
No,
she should be living in sewage, just like April.
That's
April,
right.
April's apartment had some grunge to it. That bathroom looked disgusting.
Well, you got four fucking turtles living with you, dude, and a rat. Come
I don't
on.
Know. April had that spiral staircase. That's a really nice
all right,
touch.
The first one, it's a little grungy. The second one, it's gorgeous.
Yeah, sorry. I'm talking about Secret of the Use awesome
yes,
apartment.
Gotcha.
Not part one living above a fucking disgusting antique store. I'm glad that shit burned to the ground.
But yes, to your point, this place is insane.
It's crazy.
It's literally
the view.
Walls are carpeted somehow. Like it's so disgusting.
I would love to live in an apartment like that to have that matte painting of Metropolis outside of my window.
There's a robot woman is in the fucking foreground the entire
it's
time.
Like fucking Don Draper's last apartment.
Yeah, it does remind me a lot. I mean, this thing is sick, and it's like you're the person who's assigned to like the emergency room beat. Come on.
Ooh, crossover. So Don Draper has a new account, right?
Mm-hmm.
Uh-oh, it's the Cenobites. He's trying to market the puzzle box.
Why is it we buy puzzle boxes? Do we ever stop and think? You're driving one night, you pull over to the side of the road, you're tired. Family's yelling in the back seat. Go into the store, pick up a pack of smokes. What's that? A puzzle box. Something that solves all the problems of your life. Or will it? Now I'm going to cry about my father.
I'm sold, Don, but it needs a fun name. Like, I don't know, something snappy. Rubik's.
We all like pleasure. Some of us like terrible. And some of us like
good pleasure. What I'm saying is maybe there's no difference.
It's true.
Zooby, zooby, zoo.
Zooby, zooby, zool.
Yes.
Oh, yeah, dude, absolutely.
But, yeah, so it's a stupid thing. She got this apartment. They start talking, and she's like, yeah, you know, this is, you know, my buddy got killed because he was playing with this thing. And she pulls out the puzzle box
right.
that she stole. But the puzzle box at this point, I think, is it still brass or is it back to puzzle box formation?
It's grody still at yes. this point, because a few minutes later in the film, someone remarks like, I think it's Joey's like, oh, Terry cleaned up the box
or
something like
yes,
that.
Yeah, okay.
But yeah, it still looks like the, you know, the outside of the Statue of Liberty. It's all yeah. green and, you know, weathered and whatnot.
Did you know it was gold and it was given to us from France?
Copper, I think.
Copper, you're right. Yeah. But yeah, so anyways, she's like, okay, cool. Mind if I stay for a while?
And therein is the rub, dude. I'll tell you whatever you want to hear about this puzzle box as long as I can sleep over.
But she does say she has a guest room. Yeah. So not only that apartment, but a guest
God
room?
Damn it.
A guest room.
I'm seeing an awfully lot of hungry mans there in the freezer. You know you got a hungry woman here. Do you think I could stay?
Because then it's not just, can I stay? Then her boyfriend's coming over. You know what I mean? Like, yep. And he's like, yo, babe.
Yeah. No, and then his friend Garth is in town.
Exactly.
Look out for Garth, dude.
And there's parties going on.
I thought your boyfriend exploded. Well, this was the one that didn't explode.
And Garth has got a crush on Joey now. Oh, boy.
Oh, shit.
You know, Garth is single.
You know, Garth watches you sleep. Isn't that cute? And he loves you.
Don't worry about that. The wig comes off.
And yeah, definitely, I'll tell you more about the puzzle box tomorrow. But tonight, could you pick up a pack of six natties, natty ices for me and the boys?
So
watch it, Hellraiser 2. It's going to be awesome.
I heard good things about this sequel.
Could you get it from the fridge? I know it's more expensive than just getting the pack, but could you? I mean, I need a cold one.
There's a great scene while Joey is sort of interviewing Terry, where we go back to the boiler room and JP's apartment, where he's got this sculpture hanging out, and he notices that like the cube has been ripped out.
Yeah.
And like you would, this dude sticks his hand in there and this fucking hilarious rat puppet bites him. Oh, it's glorious.
This rat is going for gold. It's holding on and it's like spraying blood all over his apartment. Onto the puzzle box, which kind of harkens back to the first
statue, right?
Yeah, I'm sorry, the statue.
And
which
it
harkens,
sizzles.
Yes, and the statue eats his blood, and he's like, that's weird.
Why is blood special in these movies? Blood is not special. You could see blood is everywhere.
Because fucking Hellraiser, Pinhead is essentially a vampire who just licks you to death, like suckles at your neck. He doesn't like even bite in, it seems like, in that first one.
There's no vampirism, but right. the blood is like
But doesn't he suck them dry essentially in that first one?
The brother Frank, yes. who's then yes. becoming yeah. reanimated in that movie, needs blood to reconstitute his body.
Yeah, Pinhead's kind of an also-ran in that movie. He's like, what's really Frank's show? I'm just kind of here to give support.
That's what was great about it, because he was used sparingly. Because yes. this is just, you
it's
know, you can't do
much
too much.
Pinhead.
Exactly.
It's way too much Pinhead.
And that's like, you know, the problem with all of these franchises is like the main like killer or villain or yeah. monster or whatever comes more and more to the forefront. They're in it more and more and more. Yeah. Like you watch that first Nightmare on Elm Street, Freddy's barely in that movie.
Yes, exactly.
And by the time, you know, Freddy's Dead, the Final Nightmare runs around, he's fucking hee-hawing through the whole thing.
Suddenly every episode's about Kramer.
yeah. Which I have no problem
with. I don't. But I'm just saying, like, they take the character that everyone latched onto, and now you have to fucking have only that and just get that.
Well, I kind of want to. Now I want a Hellraiser 3 with a laugh track and, like, an applause whenever Pinhead shows up. Woo! Pinhead!
Oh, please, someone cut part of that movie and put it to YouTube.
Whoa. Kenny? Kenny Rogers? Roasters? Chicken?
I'm sorry, I cut you off.
I was just gonna say, so after I watched this, I was going through the rest of the movies. I've seen all of these. I did it a couple of years ago just to finally bite the bullet.
Well, that is a bullet you bit.
Yeah, no, I ate shit hard for this, but I was going back through, I think, our mutual favorite one, the Hell World, the fucking video game one with Superman, or mm-hmm. maybe not Superman anymore. But like what was happening was Amazon's getting really lazy with their trailers. A lot of misrepresentation here. It's just like 60 seconds from the movie for a lot of these things.
Oh, interesting.
Including Hellraiser Hellworld. So it's not Tom Welling. What's his name?
Henry Cavill.
Henry Cavill, like, coming into his girlfriend's apartment. And it's like they're so in on Pinhead by this point that he's like, this Hell World's coming out. We're going to go to the Hell World convention party or whatever. And she's like, oh, if I have to hear one more thing about these Cenobites and your best friend Pinhead and the fucking puzzle box. And I'm like, so now it's like mainstream, man. You fucking sold out, Pinhead, man.
It was the North American rights.
Also, this is the first movie where Pinhead is called Pinhead on screen.
It's true.
So that's something. Hey, that's something for the kids.
So the blood goes on, and now the statue is kind of alive, even though it was definitely doing evil shit before it became alive. So question mark, what?
Yeah. How old is this rat?
That's a great question.
Well, is this Splinter? Is this how Splinter becomes Splinter?
To be fair, the rat could only be like 4 or 5 years old because Pinhead was around in the late 80s, man.
Did we talk about it already? How did he become a statue? Did the cement mixer fall on his head?
Because that's not how the second movie ends.
Oh, big boy, not the bath. Not the bath, big boy.
Right? He doesn't get a bath at the end of that second movie. No, he's like defeated.
Well, the lady shows him the star, Kirsty is her name. Ashley Lawrence is the actress. Yeah. That's what I love. Is like what I love about horror sequels is like, the most no-name actors, because they like work out their contracts, get a special appearance by Ashley Lawrence.
And I forgot how much this third movie ties into the first two. So I was like, what the fuck? And I had to look it up and I was like, oh yeah, that's
why.
She
shows him a picture of old Pinhead and he like kind of... He's like, thank you. And then this evil doctor, Cenobite, kills him. It just kills them both.
You're free, Pinhead. You're free.
But that's why I was also saying, Steve, at the beginning of the episode, that I felt that this was sort of like a mashup of scripts, because it's like, here's this evil statue. How did Pinhead get there? Well, we just kind of put him there because we wanted it to be a Hellraiser movie. Instead, it was like some script about a haunted sculpture or something.
Also, you could have introduced or promoted one of the other Cenobites. You know, if Pinhead's natural course had run in part two, it's not that hard to make one of these things look... Well, I guess in this movie, it's hard to make them look good, but I could use some Butterball, man. Butterball, the Cenobite in the first movie.
R.I.P. He dies too.
He dies in the second movie.
Yeah, they show a picture of he just turns into like a fat dude.
They show a picture of him.
What would you do with a strange attitude? Would you stand up and go to hell with me?
A single tear comes out of his sunglasses.
That's right. He does have sunglasses.
Yes, he's so stupid. Every time I'm watching a Hellraiser movie, I just go, where's Butterball? And the fact that he's named Butterball, which I read online, I was just Googling fat Cenobite.
These Cenobites are named exactly the way these motherfuckers name predators, dude. Because we're not calling anybody anything.
No, I think Butterball is a classic name.
Yeah.
Pinhead's a classic name. Chatterer, classic name.
Oh, Chatterer, of course. But like later in this film, you have Camerahead, Dreamer, Pistonhead, Barbie. I mean, these are just things that they were called in the script so you could fucking tell them apart.
You have to be pissed in the head to like this.
The fuck one is Barbie? Is that supposed to be what Terry turns into?
No, the bartender.
Yes. The bartender.
He's got barbed wire around his head.
And he's barbecuing people because he can spit fire.
All right. Ooh.
So the statue drinks up some blood, and he's like, that's weird. And, you know, Terry is looking into some other stuff. She finds some B-roll from the first movie or the second movie.
Oh, you will find B-roll lying around, dude.
And it's basically...
Oh, they left some of the movie here.
It's the special appearance by Ashley Lawrence where she kind of tells everybody what Pinhead is and how to put him in the puzzle box.
Yeah, is this video... like? So she was, like, what, arrested and sent to an insane asylum?
Yeah.
She's, like, being videotaped, like, yelling at... someone.
Anyone
who will listen.
Well, Kurt Russell's there. He's listening to the whole story in a whole different way.
What are you referencing?
Sick Vanilla Sky reference, dude.
Jesus, I have no memory.
It looks exactly like that room that they're in. Where they're
I'm saying I have no memory at all of Kurt Russell being in Vanilla Sky.
Oh, yeah, he's the psychologist. Yeah.
Oh, fuck.
I wouldn't put it past the Scientologist, speaking of Tom Cruise, to turn people into Cenobites at the end.
Oh, could be.
Mm-hmm, that's what they're waiting for.
That's the big transformation.
And
dude,
as bad as these names are, they're going to be worse. So, Chad, the Cenobite.
Oh, fuck. Look out for Chad, dude.
David Miscavige, the Cenobite.
Oh, that guy's definitely a Cenobite.
Esther, the Cenobite.
They, so she, whatever. So she's kind of like, that's weird. And like, but at this time, both Terry and Joey are becoming fast friends. There's like a breakfast scene that's kind of fun.
Here's this breakfast thing that I was like,
get out of
this,
my house.
This yeah. lady is like a few fries short of a happy meal here, man, because she's Joey wakes up to like her kitchen in flames, basically. And Joey's like, or Terry's like holding a cookbook and she's got something on the stove. It's flaming. And she's like, oh, I tried to make breakfast. This is my first time. And I'm like, okay. And Joey's like, don't worry, I'll take it from here. And she takes the pan. And you guys notice this? All that was in the pan were two pieces of toast?
Yeah.
What is any of that? It's like Larry the Cable Guy making breakfast.
I think they cast an older woman to play a 12-year-old.
Dude, yeah, it's like, made you breakfast in bed.
You didn't see it. She's reading from Julia Child's Pan Toasting.
Oh, right, yeah.
Who to put the bread in the pan?
That's from her early work when she sucked.
The art of American pan toasting.
But toast, that's fucking Charlie Brown shit, man. Just toasted popcorn on Thanksgiving, you sad fuck.
God, I can't even look at that meal. It's so sad.
It's so sad. But yeah, so she's like, and at this point, I'd be like, yo, you got to leave in 5 minutes or I'm going to call the cops. I'm not trying to be a dick or nothing.
Yeah.
But 5 minutes and I'm calling the cops.
And Terry keeps pulling the like, oh, geez, I guess I'll just go live in the street again. And Joey falls for it. I'd be like, yeah, that's right. Pretty much total stranger. Get the fuck out of here.
Do you have a family? What the fuck is going on here?
Great question, dude.
We cut back to the boiler. So they're becoming kind of fast friends. They go on the journey together. They go to the art gallery. This is the it burned down 20 years ago nonsense.
I can't believe this, though, this scene where they break into the art gallery. Because they break in. Some guy is walking his dog outside, and he's like, the owner's been traveling for months.
Yeah.
You know, it's closed. And she's like, bullshit, my friend bought something here a couple days ago. And he's like, oh, maybe from a haunted hobo. I don't know.
I did see a haunted hobo sniffing around there.
So they break in. And then, like, you break in, man. You, like, get in and get out. They sit down and they're, like, reading documents. Yep. Like, take everything and go back to your amazing apartment.
The statue apparently came from like an old asylum that closed down.
Oh, right. That's right.
Which is like, still doesn't answer my question of how did he get into the statue?
No.
And what happened to Butterball is the question.
Thank you.
Oh, why isn't Butterball in the statue too?
Oh, maybe Butterball got promoted.
Maybe
he's like, he's Pinhead's boss now.
Oh God.
Or it's not cement. It's just liquid Butterball. Like all of his fat just instantly like turned to liquid when it got boiled too much.
And you'll
like,
all be living inside my Butterball.
He's like candle wax.
That would be great if that was the panel next to the statue. Butterball, 1989. By Cenobite.
I don't get it.
Mixed media.
yeah, which by the way, we were coming up on the sex scene.
Oh right, yeah, this is where
this all
haunts you.
I avoided this movie ever since this experience happened to me, and I'm glad I watched it because I was like, this is not. It was way worse in my head. Yes. What I was playing for the past 20 years in my head was way different.
I was gonna say.
But, It's JP. He's just kind of going around his club. He's like, you know, looking for ladies. He finds this one lady, kind of talks her up, like, you know.
Gives the rose, dude.
Gives the rose, starts talking her up. We cut to a very explicit sex scene, which is uncomfortable. You read the IMDb trivia, this actress was uncomfortable with nudity. And the compromise was, what if the dude has his hands on your breast the entire time?
Oh, God. Is that right?
And holding on for dear life. Holy
dude, it's
shit.
Like he's on the fucking cart in a roller coaster with these things.
And
he's
also,
on the rail in a perfect storm.
Oh, God. Yeah, they're both on a rail.
Oh, yeah. Where is the cocaine use in this movie, by the way? Because come on.
They're fucking in front of this statue, and the statue is into it.
He's watching.
I'm getting hornier by the second. With each delicious thrust, I come closer and closer
And so did I towards the television set when this was on when I was 11 years old.
So what's that story? What happened?
So my uncle was watching this movie and I was like, you know, walking by and like
watching part three specifically.
Yes, specifically this movie.
Sounds like an Uncle Terry to me, man. What? An Uncle Terry, an uncle commentary.
Oh yeah. This one's alive. Maybe I could rope him into that. He would say no. So I'm walking by and I see this vigorous sex scene.
Sure. Yeah, this guy's like, pumping away, man.
Wait a second. What is this? Oh, is that a naked lady? I'm going to like peek around and stay and watch this is about.
Oh, so it's less of what are you watching and more of a what are you watching?
Exactly. And I'm watching this. And then also like another layer to it is my mother was an artist and I had been around a lot, especially in that time. Sure. Mixed media was huge.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Seen statues, seen paintings with faces coming out of them.
Can I ask you, did your mother's, her statues turn like a sunglass thing constantly?
Like sunglasses display?
The chintziest goddamn statue I've ever seen.
No, she was not a sculptor. But I've seen sculptures, mm-hmm. and I don't remember any turning like this.
Yeah.
So it was very supernatural to see how this thing turned.
No Oakleys on it. Okay. That's...
But then the chains come out. It rips off her skin, and it's this naked, bloody. Well, naked. No, naked without skin.
Fleshless. The most naked you could get.
Exactly. Just and in my mind, it's been recycled over and over again as like. It's focusing on this for a while, and she's like floating in the air, which is not even what happens.
No.
She's like standing.
Yeah, he has sex with her, and then she's like walking around his apartment, like, wow, you got a lot of dark art here. He's like, and he's being a shithead. He's like, gotta leave now, babe.
Give me my shirt back and get the fuck out.
And the chains do come at this point and rip her flesh off. She's screaming. And then she gets sort of sucked into this statue, right? Or does he move her? No, he gets sucked into.
She gets sucked in. It's very much like the end of Nightmare on Elm Street where the mom gets pulled through the window or whatever. Yeah. It's that kind of like cheesy. Oh, actually, no, I'm misremembering it. It's even worse. It's like you see there's some bad 90s CGI for part of it. And I think eventually when she like folds over, then it looks more like the nightmare effect. But there's some bad computer graphics in this movie.
So the statue noms are all up, right?
And they
start having this conversation where like the guy's like, whoa, what the fuck, you're a statue? And he's like, yes, I'm a dark evil statue. And he's like, you're evil. He's like, yeah, so are you. You just had sex with that woman.
I think it's fucking hilarious though, because like there's all this other stuff that's still part of the statue, but all that's moving is Doug Bradley's face, and like the color doesn't even match up. Like the two green tones are totally off. It's embarrassing.
It's Planet Hollywood nonsense.
Yes, you would see this in a Planet Hollywood if anyone gave a shit.
I've had an itch on my face for 5 years. Get me the fuck out of here.
And so they strike up a bargain, right? And which I don't understand. It's like, he's like, oh, good. Now you will bring me new flesh and I shall have a body and I'll give you all the pleasures you can imagine, which is like, I'm incredibly rich. I'm a really good looking dude. Like,
Did you see the sex I just had?
Like it should have been a
worst case scenario. I'm paying for it, which is totally fine.
I can afford it. Did you see that fancy restaurant I have? Not bad, Pinhead. Not bad
it
at all.
It only works in like Little Shop of Horrors. You need like a Rick Moranis type guy.
Yes, oh, man. You know?
Some bookish dude.
I shall show you such delicious sights. See more.
Feed me.
Exactly. It is Little Shop.
It is kind of.
Because now he's recruited to feed this fucking thing.
Which again, like, I don't know, man. I got a club and a restaurant to run.
Yes, he's a busy man. But if he's going to sign this deal with Pinhead, I need a montage of like this dude bringing ladies back, like, and they're just like going in and not coming out over and over and over again, kind of a thing.
That'd be fun.
Cause it's just like he eats the one lady, and then like later in the movie, spoiler alert, he winds up eating JP instead of Terry.
Yeah.
And that's it. And then he's out. And so you just needed one more? Yeah. What the fuck?
Why not just do it then? He gets close enough to you. Yeah. Just fucking let your goddamn things out.
Yeah, quit dicking around, Pinhead.
I guess Pinhead didn't have the math. Wow, that worked. Cool.
A deliciously convenient miscalculation.
I
this is embarrassing, but yeah, take some time, get someone else, because I can't get them up again right after I just win.
I need a smoke, maybe a water.
I do
put on
love
a little Leno and go to sleep.
When you see the statue's eyes open for the first time, it's when the fucking is occurring. Yeah. And it's just like, my, do I smell some fucking in this room? Good morning, Pinhead, indeed.
I mean, if I was JP, fine. You're going to make me the god of all the terrible pleasures. That's fucking great and everything. Get a lawyer in there to make sure this statue's on the up and up. Yes. That you're going to get like good god powers and not just get your fucking skin ripped off.
Yeah, dude, because Pinhead will respect the rule of law.
Well, that's I did sign that contract.
It's never.
Don't want to go to court.
Well, that's the thing. It's never. Pinhead's not like the devil, where it's like, I'll give you your heart's desire. You will become the new Tonight Show host, or what? You know what I mean? Or what? Like,
oh wow.
Go on, but thank you, Pinhead. It's amazing. Wow, cool.
Oh wow, they were gonna go with Letterman, and then I made a deal with a Cenobite.
Oh wait, all I have to do is feed you Conan.
Oh, but it is cursed, because you will go on at 10 p.m. first, and you'll be damned to your garage. Not even Kevin Eubanks will respect you after this. Look, he's leaving. He's not coming back. He's not going to be on the show.
Oh, if you don't do what I say, Jay Leno, I'll replace you with that fall-down drunk James Fallon.
And then you'll be rightfully cast asunder into Jay's garage.
You'll be relegated to CNBC.
That's it. I'm releasing James Corden.
Oh, oh, no. No, but that's not what he does. He's like,
it'll be really cool sex stuff, and that's kind of it. I can tell that's your bag, so the lie I tell you will be something about hot yet weird sex stuff.
And that's it. It's like, oh, the flesh. It's like, no, I don't know. Give me money. Give me power, whatever.
Demand an actual something up front, JP.
Yeah, this is why you hire Alan Dershowitz to come in there with you and talk to the Cenobite.
No, why? Because he is a Cenobite? Yeah.
I guess. Oh, I promise you, JP, after we're done with all of this litigation, you will have a summer invitation to Martha's Vineyard. Mark my words.
You know, all the Cenobites, they don't talk to me anymore since I've defended him. Yeah. They all turn their back. They don't even let me in their reading groups.
The Dersh was bummed out getting fucking snubbed by these Cenobites on the Vineyard, dude. Couldn't even believe it.
The Dersh.
You know, I run into Butterball at a restaurant. He's eating like 1,000 clams, and I'm like, great. You know, I'm trying to sit down, and you know, he just doesn't talk to me.
1,000 clams.
You know, I saw CD the other day, and he didn't even. He usually plays a little Billie Holiday for me. Wouldn't even do that.
So, yeah, he calls up. He's now under Pinhead's control. He calls up Terry at Joey's house. Joey's out at work and doing research or whatever. And she's like, oh, you know, and Terry's like, you know, it's like an abusive ex-boyfriend kind of a thing where she's like, yeah. I'm not coming back to you, you son of a bitch. I don't want to see you ever again. But she's like, you know, under his thrall or whatever. And he's like, come on, babe, I've changed, whatever. And she hangs up the phone. She's like, no, I'm going to stay at Joey's apartment. Then this guy, another guy calls up and she sends it right to the answering machine. And the guy's like, hey, Joey, it's me, Tommy. You got that job in Monterey. Guess you can sell your condo now. Talk to you later. And it's like, wait, what?
I thought this was a slick move by JP.
Oh,
or maybe a Pinhead prank phone call.
Hello, silly ass.
Like, yeah, I thought it was like some trick of the demon world.
How does a chest sizzle?
I was confused too, because she's like, after this, she writes a note to Joey. She's like, have fun in Monterey, you liar. And I'm like, was there a conversation, a deleted scene specifically where she's like, well, I'm definitely not taking any jobs in Monterey right now.
If you get any phone calls from me mentioning a job in Monterey, it's a prank phone call.
Monterey?
Yeah.
Yes, you will go and trace the footsteps of John Steinbeck. You'll be damned to Cannery Row.
And also, that's a demotion. You want to stay in New York, unless it's like, I don't know, maybe it's an anchor position in Monterey, and then you're going to work your way back.
I don't know. That's why I thought it was all a phony phone call. But also, like, again, because it's her presumption, that she's going to live there forever and they're going to be fucking best buds.
Well, she is telling this guy, JP, she's like, oh, Joey's going to get me a job at the news station. Like, things are really looking up for me now.
Oh, Joey's going to get me a job at the news station. You know what, Joey? That's the last thing you want to do, is get a complete stranger a job at your place of employment.
Well, I think that's a means to an end. And then you just
it? Because then it's like, okay, I'm working with them. I'm living with them.
Yeah, that's tough.
Yeah.
Well, then she can introduce her to Doc the cameraman, who's awfully lonely these days.
I see. And
that's
he's
true.
Got an extra room in his house.
He's got several.
So she winds up going back and kind of like almost hooking up with Joey. And then there's this great scene where Pinhead, like, the hooks can't come out quite enough. And he's like, a little closer to the statue, miss.
Oh, I can't reach her, JP. Closer.
Oh, God damn it. It's stuck in the door. It won't go down across the chest.
Oh, this is like an obnoxious seatbelt, isn't it? My God.
Joey, we've got a tangle. Joey, JP, a tangle?
I do kind of appreciate that this movie has two female leads kind of leading the movie.
Yeah, yes,
for sure.
But so why the fuck? Okay thing about
That is the one thing. It cycles winning the Bechdel test, but it keeps failing it because they keep bringing up other dudes.
It's like, all JP or Pinhead.
Exactly. We have many scenes of two women talking, but it's like, yeah, but then that pin is like, oh fuck, you were this close.
But is Pinhead now, isn't he genderless now that he's a Cenobite?
He's a dude.
Yeah.
I promise you, Chris Cabin, I am a dude.
I don't
party, dude. Look, I can open beer bottles on these pins.
Butterball is crude but rude. Chatterer is a party dude. And the female Cenobite does machines. She just does machines.
Ew. She literally does machines. All she fucks are sex machines. She does them.
Hide your refrigerators.
Refrigerator fetishist, Chris Cabin.
Yeah. So, Fridge Perry, sign me up. No, but so then the statue eats JP and Pinhead is reborn.
Here is the most unfortunate part of this scene. Yeah, so there's a little bit of a scuffle between JP and Terry.
Yeah.
And like Steve said, he gets eaten. As does JP's hilariously oversized leather jacket he's wearing in this movie.
Yeah. Nice.
Dude, there is some ridiculous 90s clothing going on here.
Oh, did you think that's where he got, like, he repurposed leather jacket for his outfit kind of a thing, maybe, or no?
Oh,
they just get those leather outfits. I don't know where they're getting these leather outfits.
Exactly. Custom shop.
Yeah, but like, is in hell? Are they
Hell's custom shop?
Yeah, Satan's tailor has been working fucking overtime.
Yeah, you got tailors in hell.
I guess hell invented black leather. Like, everyone up there in the Bronze Age had like brown leather.
Oh, in hell we're making black leather.
So much of the Cenobites just look like they're wearing cheap Halloween costumes.
They look like they're like fucking, you know, they look like Wes Borland.
This is actually pleather. We're not monsters.
I think I've actually seen like at least one Limp Bizkit video where he's wearing, Wes Borland is wearing a Pinhead jacket. Just that long coat.
That sounds more of a Slipknot thing. It feels like they got their whole thing.
Wes Borland was always all about, I'm going to stand out in this really bad band.
Yeah.
Like, I'm going to be in something, dude. You got to do something.
You do have to do anything.
where your band is made up of 90% leg tattoos and BO, yeah, you got to stand out.
So at this point, Joey goes to sleep. She wakes up in a dream. She's back in Vietnam, but then we transform into World War I.
That's what I love. It's like, first we're in Vietnam for like a hot second in this scene, and then you're like, wait a minute. Well, look at all these holes that they're all in. Oh, World War What? What?
And we meet...
Welcome to War World. It's all, every war is going on at the same time.
Captain Elliot Spencer, who is actually Pinhead. Sort of, kind of.
Bradley looks like... Hugo Weaving.
Yeah, a little bit.
Big time.
Yeah, mixed with Mr. That. Pitt.
Oh, wow. Yes. Holy shit. That's very accurate.
He actually did. I thought he would play like a random admiral in a Star Wars movie.
Oh,
maybe.
He totally
He has
could
that
be.
Look to
he
him.
He could have.
That'd
yeah.
be nice. Hey, first order's hiring.
We didn't talk about, I'm sorry to backtrack for 2 seconds, but we didn't talk about how disgusting it is when Pinhead comes out of that statue.
It takes a while, first of all.
It does, but like, there's definitely just like Ghostbusters looking ejaculate all over the place.
Oh,
there's
right.
like slime and ooze.
It's also just like a little lazy. Like I would imagine like exploding like a flesh statue. Just like yeah. they're throwing pieces of flesh on the ground like, ooh.
It's very lazy.
And then there's just this slop everywhere.
It's gross.
I kind of feel like, and what's the deal? He strikes the terror. He's like, don't worry about it. You'll be good, man. It's cool.
You're fine.
Do you have somebody to come and clean this up? Somebody in the boiler room.
You're good because I can't get these chains up after I go, you know.
There's
Do you want to put on a cool movie for a while?
maybe before bed, another romp.
Just give me a few minutes watching PCU on VHS. We'll see where this goes. Have you seen Goodfellas yet? It's just astonishing. New on VHS.
During this flashback to World War One, so she starts getting into it with Doug Bradley as Corporal Elliot, whatever the fuck.
Yeah.
And she definitely has the line, I just walked into madness for you. And you're like, oh, ew.
There's also a dumb line of like, what the hell is going on here? And then somebody else is like, hell is very going on here. It's like, what the fuck are you talking about?
His evil is too powerful at some point. I'm like, what the fuck does that mean?
Well, so I guess this is like, this guy's in purgatory or something.
Yeah.
And Pinhead is like hell guy who went to Earth. And now like, they hatch a plan with this ghost to like merge him, who represents the humanity of the man who was once Pinhead.
Yeah.
To combine it with Pinhead.
Yeah. To which this guy, Doug Bradley's like human character goes, huh, probably never shaken hands with a ghost before.
Actually, I have once.
So wait, is the Nom Daddy the ghost that's like bringing this all together?
Oh, my Nom Daddy, look out.
What? Oh, when you said Nom Daddy, I thought you meant the statue because nom, 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 nom.
I apologize.
Okay.
A lot of noms
the Vietnam Daddy.
Yeah. Joey's father.
I think he's just
a hapless idiot ghost,
I think he uses her dreams to it. Sort of like whatever, and she's just dreaming about her dad.
Yeah.
But to lead to the guy that's going to stop him?
Yeah.
We're just going to Kruger Town now.
Yeah, I guess.
Also, I don't understand how you're having dreams about people you've never met. She clearly says that he died before she was born.
Hey, Clive, it's me, Wes. Yeah. Caught the new Hellraiser. Great, great, great. Thought we talked no dreams. Thought we were pretty clear on the whole who got the dream part of the street there.
Oh, and then what was that? Oh, I caught that third one. Bringing him right into the real world, huh? Making him whole again, huh? Okay. Just checking.
Whatever, buddy.
You know what? Have a great Christmas.
Would you like a nipple ring?
I've got plenty of Wes Craven. I got enough. I really do.
Should I be calling Clive or Anthony about this? Is the question here. Who's getting the phone call?
Oh, I totally forgot. I think Eric said it, but yeah, there definitely is that line. Dreams of one war are dreams of
really?
All war. Yeah,
I did not. Okay,
it's a real line that I jotted down. It's another Elliot Spencer line.
I guess that's where I remembered it from because I actually didn't remember that. So that's.
This guy also refers to himself. He says, I was an explorer of hidden pleasures. Dude, you're just a pervert. World War One pervert.
Thailand pedophile. That's what that says. Yes, right there.
Exactly.
Because what are we talking about? So, sex tourism, cannibalism, maybe.
Yeah.
Right? Hunting people for sport. I think those are the three.
Well, that's what I don't understand is like the idea at the end of this movie or the middle part of this movie where it's like, I'm the good part of it. No, you're like even worse, kind of. At least
you fucking started it, asshole.
He was a demon. He can't help it.
You were picked. True. You were handpicked by the devil to become Pinhead. Exactly. That's how fucking bad you are.
You were recruited out of high school, dude. Because you were so good at being a fucking creep.
So he finds that box, and that's how it all starts, and he becomes Pinhead. But like, again,
This box. I know you might have said it was made out of wood once, but what the fuck with this box?
I don't know. I honestly don't know what the box.
So it's already like that beautiful metalish shape.
Yeah.
In 1918, I guess.
Yeah.
All right.
I mean, dude, yeah, it's just a big old shoulder shrug.
Okay.
I'm sure there's some Wikipedia page that explains it all, but I
can't. All the Knights Templar built it.
That's what you would expect, right? Yeah. But then that next movie, it's just like, oh, I'm carving it from some wood. Oh, my wife doesn't approve of my project. Oh.
I was an explorer of pleasures. I would get chicken nuggets with a regular sized meal.
I was the first guy to put ranch on pizza.
What a decadent life I had.
Disgustingly delicious.
I had the thought of pumping cheese into the crust. And yes, the devilish feat of eating it backwards.
Dip that fry in the frosty now.
Just like weird choir music as it's going slowly and slowly towards the shake.
Kevin, I think Pinhead was with us at Neptune Diner when I started when I started dipping French fries into lobster bisque.
Yes. Oh fuck, dude, that is the most decadent thing you can do.
That's decadent as fuck.
I was a young man, an explorer of tastes.
Yeah, dude, and an explorer of your bathroom with fucking diner bisque, dude.
I had to call you out for the not getting cheese fries.
Yeah, yeah. Well, Neptune Diner's bisque is a cut above.
Ah. You best believe I created disco fries. That's right, gravy on cheese fries.
I was a connoisseur of pleasures. I one Sunday I didn't get dressed at all, and I watched all of the Harry Potter movies. They were on Sci-Fi, and I just kind of couldn't get out of the couch.
Behold, the KFC double down.
Yeah, dude, that was created by Satan himself.
Now, I know what you're thinking. You might want to pin nachos on me, but no, that was the man upstairs.
Yeah, dude, definitely created by God. Absolutely.
The one Lord.
Oh, dude, Nacho Lord? I would pray to that guy. I don't pray, but if I did, I'd pray to a nacho god.
I was just thinking of a really fat fucking Star Lord, Nacho Lord.
Yep. Dude seated at the right hand of the taco, dude. Don't even worry about it. That is a religion I can get behind.
So the plan is like, look, all you need to do is bring him here to Limbo and I'll punch him in the nose.
Or I'll give him a good slobber knocker.
So like, that's the plan.
Excuse me.
Slobber knocker. It's a...
Is that a fellatio move?
No, it's a rat.
It's an Albany like expression.
It sounds like it would be. It's a wrestling thing.
My God, it's going to be a slobber knocker tonight, boy.
Oh, my God. Jim Ross just said fellatio on the air. Let's just pretend it's a wrestling move.
We'll fold it in. It'll be in every broadcast now.
Yeah, now we got to do it every time so the audience doesn't think we're talking about dicks.
So, whatever. This is the big Pinhead scene, his coming out party. He gets into the boiler room.
Oh.
And this is when he kills like 30 people.
It's huge, awesome.
It's pretty damn
I gotta
good.
30?
Yeah. Well, yeah.
That's a low fucking... Well,
you show 30 deaths
yes,
at once.
Yes, okay, that's fair.
You know what? This movie's pretty short. I could have had this sequence be 10 minutes.
Yeah.
Because the one thing I will say about most of these movies, really good practical effects.
Yeah, sure.
And it's also, Pinhead is getting pretty creative here. It's not just fucking flaying everybody.
Yes.
There's a dude who gets a mouth full of pool balls. My God.
Some lady's having a drink. The ice in the drink leaves the drink, turns into Pinhead's face.
Oh, yeah.
And then stabs her in the face.
It's pretty fucking cool, man.
The weird baby fucking monster starts fucking dancing.
Oh, that thing was weird. I didn't know what to make of that.
Well, there's like a fun doll that's just a baby doll hanging from a thing because it's a scuzzy club, and then it starts like dancing and killing people, sort of.
Oh, that's right. It was part of the decor at the boiler room. Oh, I forgot.
Yes, the barbed wire guy also is art decor, and then he goes onto the bartender.
Yep. And then the CDs start cutting people. There's a lot of CD death in this.
Lots and lots. More so than, what was that Dolph Lundgren film?
I Come in Peace.
Yeah, a lot of CD death in that movie too, but it couldn't hold a candle to Hellraiser 3, Hell on Earth.
It's not compact disc. It's compact death.
Oh.
Eric Siskel, ladies and gentlemen.
I'm clapping for myself.
Then Joey is watching television. There's a news report like, oh my God, the boiler room is like under siege. You know, everything's really bad. And then she's like, oh my God, I got to go there. But uh-oh, the TV was unplugged the whole time.
Oh man, doesn't that just fucking steam your clams, dude? Whatever. She calls up Doc and she's like,
oh,
Doc.
Poor fucking Doc. Doc is at home
sleeping. Literally asleep. And she goes,
sleeping it off.
He's like, yeah, I was sleeping it off probably. And he's like, hello? And she goes, Doc, are you watching TV? Clearly this man just woke up. Come on.
Yeah.
And she's like, turn on channel 12. You know, there was a big massacre down at the boiler room. We got to get down there or whatever. Something's happening. Yeah. And he turns on channel 12 and it's like some, it's like La Traviata or something. Like there's an opera on. And I got to admit, I felt pretty dumb because I was like, I don't get it. Why is this TV broken? Until then, you see the unplugged television in her sweet apartment.
And Pinhead is drawing her out because Pinhead wants to destroy the box.
Right. And he knows, I guess, that she's in possession of it. Did Terry tell him?
I guess I guess Terry got to talking.
She becomes like a Cenobite herself, right?
This is when all the Cenobites start to get revealed. She goes there. She meets Pinhead. She sees all this death and destruction, almost throws up. A couple of times.
Just like me watching this movie.
Poor Doc has had his head removed and a fucking camera stuck on it.
Yeah. Oh, that sucks.
He looks like a Borg now.
He does look like a Borg.
Yeah, right? Apropos of, he looks like old John Carpenter.
He kind of does. He's the first.
I was just going to say, before the Cenobite transformation, he looks like old John Carpenter.
He looks like old John Carpenter.
When he turns into a Cenobite, he looks like a Borg.
Clive, it's about your franchise!
But he is the only mustachioed Cenobite.
That's right.
Ooh. Which I think is... I feel like Pinhead was okay with it because of the time crunch, but like really, we like to keep it clean here.
Otherwise, I think it's like the dress code of the New York Yankees, yes! Man. Magically changed those sideburns.
Like if Randy Johnson became a Cenobite, you're shaving that shit, man.
I'm slaughtering birds with baseballs left and right.
Listen, it's I love how much you're flaying everyone. You've really figured out the hook system much quicker than I did even. But it's the mustache. It's a little. It's gotta go.
I didn't even know you could use the lens to pluck a head like that. That was that was stunning.
That was an interesting choice.
Yeah, there's an interesting. He kills someone by shooting them through the head. With the camera.
Well, and then makes a close-up joke.
It's like an Anton Chigurh thing. Like he's getting up on top.
It does look like a cattle air gun thing or whatever.
Piston Head, who was J.P. Monroe or whatever.
Where did the pistons come from?
Yeah, exactly.
Because it's like, fucking, dude, like the pistons are always thrusting.
But if there was ever an opportunity for an Anton Chigurh, like murder, Piston Head, you'd think would be the guy, not Camera Head.
Yeah, that's true.
Camera Head would record it and jerk off in the corner.
And then you had...
Yeah, Pervert Head, dude.
Pervert Head.
Autofocus head, man.
Oh yeah,
that's true. He's that Cenobite just goes around hitting people over the head with lamps.
Oh, speaking of John Carpenter,
then we also have CD head guy, who's a lot of fun. I like him. He's shooting Razor CDs.
This dude was the DJ at the club, so that's I love that. Like what you were in life, you're like partially damned to continue
take
as a
your
profession.
Job down to hell with you.
You'd be podcast. Head.
Oh fuck, do we just have like microphones coming out of our eyes?
Mm-hmm.
Not bad,
I guess. Yeah. Or maybe it'll be like we're like banshees that hit a certain frequency that makes everyone poo their pants.
Oh shit. Well, dude. Yeah.
Or you'd have the board on your chest and random wires shoot out and kill people.
Totally, yeah, dude.
You know, Darth Vader kind of had a board on his chest.
He did.
I love all those buttons and knobs. Did. What the fuck was that?
He had an Arnold soundboard. That's what it was.
How are you? Yeah.
What is he doing?
I'm Detective John Kimble.
And then there's also the bartender guy.
Yeah.
Who's got barbed wire all over his face. He's got a little martini mixer in his left hand.
He does, dude. It's great. He's got like the shaker and I. As far as I can tell, he doesn't make use of it. Did I miss something?
No, he actually later in the film, the cops are like trying to get him and like he sprays them out of his mouth. And this lady cop goes, it's gasoline.
Oh, yeah.
Stands completely still.
Yep.
While she gets blown up by the
he doesn't spit, by the way. He does use the mixer, but like a bartender, he's fucking drunk. Oh. So he throws the thing. It opens halfway through. A little bit of gasoline gets on.
Oh, then he breathes fire.
Yeah. That's right, yeah.
I think also when Pinhead makes his way into the massacre here, I believe it's him that has the line, "I'm here to turn up the volume."
Oh, damn.
Yeah, dude.
I just caught that on VHS. It was a good one.
I love Happy Harry Hardon.
I thought the song Pump Up the Volume would be in it too, but strangely, it is not. Waiting the whole goddamn time.
But then, like, so they wind up going into this construction site, which, by the way, this spoiler, this movie is set in New York but filmed in North Carolina because there's fucking fir trees all over the place.
Oh, fir trees, quaint sidewalks and street lamps. Like, she's running down this street, like, towards the construction site. By the way, did you notice she passes the Elm Street Cafe?
Oh, God.
Yeah.
Yeah, waka, hey, waka.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, it's Wes again. Hi.
Not funny. Have a great Christmas.
But yeah, like this like river of electric water is chasing her down the street.
It's a river of electric water.
But yeah, so they get to this construction site and dude, yeah, it is just out in the middle of a fucking forest, this thing.
And Pinhead is up on top of something and he's like, yes, this is when she meets Pistonhead guy, who's JP, and Terry, who's smoking lady, which is, we're bringing that fetish in here. Like,
oh my God, a smoking woman.
Well, dude, that was like during the raunchy sex scene earlier in the film. JP has just got like the butt just hanging out. And yeah. He's smoking without hands and just like fucking. And I was like, this is so disgusting. This woman is getting ash all over her. My God, smoking and sex. Keep the cigarettes out of the bedroom.
Well, Terry's got like, she's doing a little bit of a Beetlejuice there. She's got the cigarette in her like throat.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But also, does she have cigarette fingers? I couldn't figure that out. Okay.
Really?
Yeah.
Does she have to like buy new ones, or are those perma cigarettes?
Well, I think they're I don't think they're fingers. She's just smoking as well as having one in the fucking.
I smoke a little bit, but I would smoke a lot more if I was a Cenobite.
Oh, absolutely, dude.
Especially if you have to. Like
if that's your Cenobite gag, right? I think they're like plastic one hitters.
Oh,
so
gotcha.
they never whittle down.
Well, she's just, how about a Weedo bite, right?
Oh yeah, dude. Sign me up. That's what you would be. I would be that. I would be the chillest Cenobite of all time, FYI.
No, have regular pleasure, not terrible pleasure. I mean, it's fine.
It's like, hey man, like why do you need to go that extreme?
You're gonna go to hell if I could ever get off the couch, all right?
Oh, more Batman the Animated Series? I'll be right here. Well,
that's what kind of sucks. Like, I don't know what exactly are Pistonhead and fucking Smoker doing.
What do
you mean? Like, you know how a CD guy can kill you with the fucking thing?
Oh, sure.
The guy's got the camera that kills you.
Yeah.
Smoker just kind of puts one out on you.
Yeah.
And then she's just like, tss, 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 tss,
and
it's
like
take a while.
And Pistonhead's just horny?
Yeah.
I don't get it. I want to see some powers.
I feel like there was probably a deleted idea there where it was like, and then Pistonhead just fucks you to death, right? It was like,
I don't know, Clive.
Smoker is just going to smoke your entire body like a cigar.
Oh, a smoking woman. Oh, she's lighting up.
But they're like kind of all around her. And then Pinhead from on high is like, yes, this is my new crew. They're a bit of, he does say, they're a shadow of my old crew, though, which is kind of like, oh, man.
May I present to you the dreaded B team. CD guy, camera dude, cigarette girl.
Pistonhead, we really ran out of ideas. It's what I had on me at the time.
Look, I just unlocked hell. Do you really want the A game? It's not going to happen. This was a short thing.
Yes, I get it. I too miss Butterball.
Do you not understand short notice? It was tonight I needed them.
There is a cab driver that gets he's an innocent bystander.
Oh, what happens to the cab driver?
He gets a fucking CD right in the head or the throat or something. Also, this is some lazy shit. Like, I appreciate the fact that they wanted to set this movie in New York City.
Sure.
Cool place to take the franchise. That's fine.
There's one actual shot of Times Square. And then
we do have a shot of Times Square. We've got some B-roll of the skyline. That's fine. But my God, when these cops are hanging out, did you catch this on their badges?
Summit Company Police?
Oh, no.
So are they like a security firm?
Yeah, it's Summit Company Security, and then they just put police on top of it.
Right. It's like, Jesus Christ, man. Get some phony NYPD things there, please. Yeah, you want a license? What? Hell, what? Yeah, all right, sure, $50.
Then, yeah, you can do that easily.
Totally.
Go cheap and just get detectives. Then you just get a fucking trench coat.
I'm cleaning up New York, okay? First of all, we're going to stop having our fucking name besmirched in Hellraisers. And
oh, God, it's the worst of the Cenobites.
Oh, that's true, yeah.
Yes, speaking of chatters, dude. Julian. The Cenobites are polluting Times Square. Where is it? Is it before or after she gets to the construction site? I think it might be after, because there's this whole scene with the church.
Oh, right. No, on her way, she stops at this church, which is like, it's a whole different movie for 5 minutes.
Yes, you know? It very much is.
Because like, oh, it would be really cool if Pinhead like fucked with a church, and that's this scene.
We drop in, this priest is like, oh, my child, there's no such thing as demons. And it's like, well, what the fuck is that?
Yeah.
You know, he comes in, he mocks like the Jesus crucifixion by pulling pins out of his head and jamming them into his own hands. And he even does the like arms outstretched, head slightly down at an angle thing.
What an edgelord loser.
Yeah, just to own the libs too. He doesn't fucking do anything. Nothing happens.
He destroys that altar though. Look out.
He destroys the altar. It takes him a while to take his pins out. It's like, are there like bugs on them or what's
I thought it was
going?
Just supposed to be like part of his brain.
Oh, I see.
Ooh, yeah. That's why he's dumb.
Yeah, he's an edgelord loser. I agree with that.
Does he kill the priest or no?
He makes the priest like eat like a false sacrament. Which
That's right. He fucking rips like part of his own body off and feeds it to this dude. And he does, like, this is my flesh, this is my blood.
And like, there's some steam coming out, but we cut away from whatever happens to this priest. I need to see it.
You see him spin it out, though. Yeah. It's got the actor's like, Patilli.
In The Rock, when he punches the green ball into the guy's mouth, that's what I need.
That, dude, precisely I intended to shove that in there.
I'm going
to
choke my money out of you.
And then he gets it.
And he has some line. It's like, so there's very Pinhead lines in this scene. He's like, I am the way.
I mean, in the way is sort of whatever.
No, I mean like that famous fastball song. I am a story of an old couple that drove away and killed themselves.
They made up their minds and then started talking. Where were they going without ever knowing the way?
They drank up the wine. Good song.
Yeah. 90s jams. So right when all of these Cenobites are on her, about to get her, she solves the puzzle box.
Yep.
And everybody goes away. We cut. We're back in limbo.
This is the line, though. This is the most important line in the entire franchise. Play with this, Pinhead.
Oh, right.
That's where it's uttered for the first time.
Right. She zaps all the Cenobites back into the box or into hell or whatever. And then we do get the dream. We're back in purgatory. She meets her daddy in Vietnam again.
And he's like, oh, you did such a great job. Why don't you just give me that box? Why don't you give me that box? Hey, babe. Oh, man. Long time no see. Why don't you give me that box?
He plays it a little cooler than that. He's just like, I don't know. They just told me to come here. Apparently, you're my like daughter, and they said you'd have something for me. I'm still getting used to the whole spiritual thing.
And so there's a box, probably a box.
Yeah, it's probably a box.
And you know, I could use it, but I lost my box in the war, as you see.
I lost my box in Vietnam. Okay.
Oh, Dad, how about here? Have this box. This is what they must mean. And then, turns out to be Pinhead in disguise.
What?
Stolen valor.
Oh, right.
Now, is
shit,
it?
We better end this scene pretty quickly. This is really illegal.
This is the evilest thing I've done. Thank you for your service, ghost man.
Is it the dad as, like, when he's revealed to be evil? Because it's kind of, he's got like a smirk really quickly kind of a thing. Does the dad say it or does like Doug Bradley as Pinhead say it? There's a line where one of the versions of this monster goes, you're so ripe, Joey, and it's harvest time.
Oh, yeah. It's a Hellraiser line.
on, dude. It's a line from a Hellraiser movie.
So, like, ghost Doug Bradley comes out. There's some fucking time cop head melding going on.
I thought there was going to be a real time cop. Like, they can't occupy the same space.
Well, they can because they merge.
Well, the weird thing is, but first, because it's Hellraiser and because we got to jerk off to something.
Absolutely.
She gets right before, like, they go back to the bunker where Hellraiser became, or Pinhead became Pinhead. And then he's like, well, I'm going to tie you up. She gets tied up. They put some, like, bondage mask on her.
Oh, that's right.
Somebody was getting somewhere with this sequence.
I think it's a thing, because I was going to say this earlier. I wish there was a thing where we saw, like, the making of a Cenobite, like, in hell. And I think this is how it starts.
No, dude, in Hellraiser 2, they...
Do we get some origin stories?
There's a guy who... This is this crooked doctor. He goes in... It's like a big version of the puzzle box, and he kind of goes in. It's like a Cenobite machine.
Oh, it is really? Oh, it's like Inspector Gadget or something.
Yeah, it's like injecting him with, like, there's a Cenobite juice.
Yes.
And now we're taking some blood.
Oh, Charlie Chaplin's in the gears.
A bunch of, like, tiny Cenobites start measuring him to see what his leather gown will be.
Okay, I didn't remember that. I haven't seen the second one in a really long time.
That's a, you're
fine, but it looks like she's on her way to being Cenobited.
Yes. Cenobitten.
Once Cenobitten.
Welcome to Cenobites. May I take your order? No, we are out of mozzarella sticks. Tired of telling everyone I'm out of mozzarella sticks. How embarrassing.
What are the specials tonight?
Brains and fuck. Wait, let me go back to my manager. Hold on, I'll just I'm sorry. It was actually flan. I said, fuck, I meant flan.
Oh, man.
I confuse those all the time.
Damn it, honey, I was really in the mood for fuck.
A hot bowl of fuck.
I'm gonna order the fuck medium rare.
Excuse me, thank you. Thank you for the drink. Is this guy going to be jerking off at our table the entire time?
Well, it's table side fuck. Yes.
Okay, it's a restaurant. That's the theme. It's a theme restaurant.
They prepare it at the table. You know, like we've been to some of those nice restaurants that do like guacamole. They prepare at the table. This guy prepares the fuck at the table. He takes his dick out. He jerks off.
Our waitress has been smoking the whole time. I don't really know if you allow that in here.
I'm sorry. I don't want to make a scene. Honestly, I'll just be quiet about it. But I found a hair in my fuck.
And in my flan.
Actually, that is how the fuck is prepared. We're doing it. It's kind of a play on the 1970s. Very hairy fuck. I should have said that. It's my mistake. We will comp you the flan.
You get a free flan, but you're paying for the fuck.
So they meld together or whatever, and then while that's going on, she turns the puzzle box into a knife.
That's something from the second one as well, where you can kind of turn, it's a fortune fire thing.
Oh, yeah, this will kill.
It's a Swiss Army box.
She says, you know, the your famous go to hell and stabs him.
Yeah.
And well, he's like, stab me, man, do it.
Oh,
like,
yes.
Because it's like good Pinhead v. evil Pinhead. He's like, I believe in you, Joey.
Yeah, like his Doug Bradley's head, like, kind of jumps back again, bad 90s CGI.
Oof, real bad.
Sort of like morphs out real quick, like, do it.
Yeah.
So she does it. Go to hell.
She escapes and, like, she wakes up literally in a forest. I mean, this is not.
I think Twilight was going on next door.
And she's like, wow, that was really something. Remember when I was trying to be a reporter? Ah, forget it. And she kind of she picks up this box, and it's a construction site, a big thing of cement. She puts it in there because she thinks that's the best move.
But, like, this is, like, the sun is just rising. Yeah. There's just wet cement, like a pool of wet cement there.
Great point.
And also it's weird because, like, and this is also a continuity error, but it shouldn't be shocking. But, like, she takes this thing and pushes it all the way down. Like, her hand gets submerged in the cement.
Yeah, how deep is this thing?
I thought something would grab her. Like,
yeah, pull her in, right? But then when it cuts to, like, a wider shot, she's like, huh, it's over. And there's no cement on either hand. She just walks away. You'd be spending at least 30 minutes getting that off.
I said it once. I'll say it again. Get on, like, a Richie Tenenbaum ship. Go to the middle of the ocean and toss the fucker down.
Oh, great. Now we got dolphin Cenobites. Wonderful.
Oh, Jesus, that'll give me nightmares.
Ooh, a megalodon Cenobite.
Oh, shit. Oh, yeah, the megabyte.
Oh, Aquaman Cenobite. Oh, yeah.
My man, Pinhead,
for his pleasures.
And then it's a weird, like, time, she walks away and like that's the end of her. Time passes and you see like the building that was built on the site and it just looks like the box. What the fuck?
Dude, it's Cenobite HQ and that's what I want the next movie to be. I
want like the Men in Black office.
Cenobite Incorporated.
Yes! Also known as Amazon.
No, this is going to be, the sequel to this movie, I didn't see it, but it should be just Gremlins 2, but with Cenobites.
Yes!
Oh, that would have been pretty great.
Right? It's in an office building.
This kind of is Gremlins 2 with like the there's an electricity gremlin. Now there's a
Cenobites. They're very gremlin-esque. Yeah. Gremlin 2-esque. Yes. Yeah, absolutely.
Bat Cenobite. There's a lady Cenobite. There's a vegetable Cenobite.
Got a Dracula Cenobite? You got a... Remember that line in RoboCop or RoboCop 2 or 3 where there's an old man at the police station giving his son like shit or whatever? It's like, oh, you got a RoboCop? Oh, you got a vampire cop? You got a...
an aqua cop?
Yeah. That I do not remember.
It's in one of those movies.
And I think it's the third one.
I cherish it. I cherish that line.
And then we just end with fucking Lemmy singing Hellraiser the song.
Yikes.
Oof.
Terrible.
What a poor use of Motorhead.
Hellraiser!
Yeah.
Okay.
All right.
I wonder when that song was written. Was it for the film or was it on a Motorhead
record? It was on a record.
Was it made before the first one? Because that should just be like the titular song.
Same year, maybe?
Do you know who wrote that song with Lemmy?
Clive.
Ozzy Osbourne, my friend.
Really? Oh, shit.
Didn't he also record a version of it?
Oh, it's a Hellraiser. It's fantastic.
I bet you anything Hellraiser is his favorite horror franchise.
It's wonderful.
Shut! Hellraiser's on!
Yeah, I'm fine. I'm going to bed again.
More of a Warlock fan, Archie. You know that. You know that.
Oh, fuck. And that's the end of this movie, man. Would anybody recommend it?
It's a light recommend. It's kind of a fun, stupid, goofy horror movie. It's a little bit extreme. And I can see, here's the thing, the whole Hellraiser franchise, if you say fuck that franchise, you're totally right.
Yeah.
If you say you're into it, fine, it's none of my business. I think the first one's fine, the second one's boring, the third one's just kind of fun and stupid, probably the dumbest of the three, but the most fun.
Yeah.
And then after that, I'll never watch one of these ever again.
It's a light recommend for me, too, because this is one of those franchises where you have to go for the stupid ones.
Yes.
The third and the fourth one, I think, are the stupidest, so those are the two I would recommend. Mm. The first two are garbage, I think. Complete trash. But I did want to bring up in the massacre scene, Zach Galligan of Gremlins is an extra murdered. Like there's a shot of him getting killed in the massacre scene.
Do you know what happens to him?
No, I mean like it's in the trivia. And Zach Galligan has some weird fucking blood oath with Anthony Hickcox because he was in both those Waxwork movies.
I remember.
And he has a fucking... Hickcox directed the second Warlock movie. For no reason whatsoever, Zach Galligan shows up as like a date at a door that Julian Sands just fucking murders.
Maybe they're like buds or something.
They could be best buds.
Oh,
Zach Galligan, Cenobite, that's what I want.
Yeah,
vegetable Cenobite.
I would like to pretend that Zach Galligan played his Gremlins character in this movie.
Oh, and that's the end of Billy? That's how he goes?
Fucking finally.
Well, if you are going to do a blood oath, I say go Joe Dante over Anthony Hickcox.
So the city was just like closed down and besieged by Gremlins right before the Cenobite outbreak. Bad timing, bad luck.
Yeah, dude.
I will say, actually, both of those franchises have a lot in common because the first one actually opens in like a similar kind of ancient Asia thing where a guy...
Oh, does it really?
The guy's like, pleasure, sir?
Right, the first one, there's an Asian man selling the box, but they're like in Egypt or something.
Yes, yeah. Okay.
That's
like
how, like...
Silk Road.
It was funny, Steve, because you mentioned this at the Big Daddy Dispatch recently, and I totally agree with you, how you will always, 10 times out of 10... forget that The Exorcist starts in Iraq. Single time.
You will put that movie on. Here we go. We're getting ready to fucking see Father Karras in Iraq.
Yeah, it's like, what? Did I put the wrong DVD? What the fuck am I in the desert for?
And it's like 3 minutes, but it's like a weird 3 minutes.
It's a weird 3 minutes. Eric Siska?
Yes, I would not recommend this. I don't like the Hellraiser series, but I think if you have to watch one of them, the first one I think is fine.
Yes.
But yeah, no. By the way, huge recommend Gremlins 2.
Yes. Yeah, absolutely.
I actually really love Gremlins 2.
That's a fun movie.
As fuck.
I would say for me, I do dislike this franchise. This is like a creaky hand recommend. It's a more competent sequel. Mm. And Chris Kaplan, I think you're batshit crazy, man, saying that like some of the earlier ones, the crazier ones, you get to the fucking Lance Henriksen video game one. You get to the fucking found footage one.
Is this a found footage one?
I think it's that's what's weird. It's half of the, this was the second to most recent one, I think.
Okay.
Within the last like 2 or 3 years, there's one where like a good chunk of the movie is found footage,
mm-hmm.
and then it totally abandons the concept, and then it's just a movie. Very stupid.
I should make a point. I didn't watch anything past Bloodline.
I stopped right there. Oh, the fucking pleasures that you can experience.
That I have happily averted.
That is Hellraiser 3 : Hell on Earth. Directed by Anthony Hickcox, Zach Galligan's best friend.
Yeah.
For more We Hate Movies, check out WHMPodcast.com.
Just got handed something from the newsroom.
Something from the news desk. What do we got?
Looks like our Patreon episode this month on Patreon.com/WeHateMovies is Van Helsing.
What?
Yeah, the Hugh Jackman movie. And if you sign up that $5 level, gang, you get so much shit. You get Ready Player One. That was last month's.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And a whole lot more.
There's tons of...
You get Bright, Man of Steel, speaking about Henry Cavill, Jungle to Jungle, tons of stuff. And you'll also get
stuff.
Animation Damnation. We're doing the Smurfs this month. That'll be fun.
So check that out. Patreon.com/WeHateMovies. Rate and review the show wherever you get it. We would greatly appreciate it. Steve Sadak, as the terrifying Halloween Spooktacular continues next week, what will we be talking about?
We're talking about a haunted dog in Man's yeah. Best Friend.
Dude, I love this movie.
It's a great movie.
Dude, he pees asses. So until next week with Lance Henriksen's Acid Pee, I'm Andrew Jupin.
Steven Sadak.
Chris Cabin.
Eric Acid Pee.
Take it easy.
Oh, I'm going to give that guy $1 million. I can't find Eric Acid Pee.
We all go a little mad sometimes.
You know, it's Halloween. I guess everyone's entitled to one good scare, huh?
Sometimes.
Zombies have entered the building. They're at the door. They're coming in.
It is time to keep your appointment with the Wicker Man.
They're coming to get you, Barbara.
These sick fucks. You've seen one too many movies.
Now, Sid, don't you blame the movies. Movies don't create psychos. Movies make psychos more creative.
What an excellent day for an exorcism.
That was a HeadGum podcast.